Okay, I think you can get started. So this is another one of those guest lectures. My name is Pratik. I work with Prashant on some of these topics on cloud computing and data centers. So feel free to ask any questions. So in today's class, we are going to be looking at sort of three main things. We're going to start with the physical infrastructure provided by data centers and look at some of those issues. Then we'll be moving up the stack to the sort of the software management layer, the scheduling and virtualization and cluster management, etc. And then so the topmost layer on infrastructure clouds and platform as a service clouds. So we'll sort of start bottom up with the infrastructure layer, then move on to the software management, and then move on to clouds and what are the new services that the clouds provide, etc., and some of the research directions in each of these three domains. So have you guys seen the MDHPC data center? Is that for the class trip? Okay. So data centers are large, right? They're the very large server farms, which have tens of thousands of machines, hundreds of megawatts of power, and especially big companies like Google, Facebook, and Apple have, and Amazon have very large data centers. And you can think of them as just a collection of servers to run all sorts of computational jobs. This is an image from one of Google's new data centers, which shows the view from the top, and here are all the server racks. So these data centers are huge, right? And they sort of exploit economies of scale to provide computing at low costs. So traditionally, we've had sort of static data centers where you have administrators which partition your physical resources to various application clusters and application types, right? And then sort of have these racks for MapReduce jobs, these racks for interactive applications, etc. But obviously that's changing into a more fluid and more dynamic model where you treat the servers as interchangeable and really fluid commodities. So if you look inside a data center, you would mostly see racks of servers everywhere. And all the associated physical infrastructure that goes with it. Need a power distribution system to power all the racks. You need cooling management systems to keep your servers cool, etc. So we'll be going over some of the issues related to power and cooling and thermal management in today's talk a little bit, and I'll point you to research directions in these areas. So let's start with the first one, that is power consumption, right? So data centers are incredibly power dense. That means that they take in a large amount of power. So a typical data center, modern typical data center, consumes in the order of hundreds of megawatts of power. Now that's a big number. A typical, let's say, coal-fired thermal plant, one unit will produce of the order of 500 megawatts. Right? So a single data center alone can consume a significant fraction of the power generated by a big power plant. And power costs are a big factor of running data centers. So the way we measure efficiency is this unit called PUE. It stands for Power Usage Efficiency. So has this been covered before? Okay. Thanks. So that basically is how much of the power you're using for powering your computing infrastructure, right, divided by the total amount of power. So you want that as close to one as possible. You want as much power to be devoted to your servers, rather than cooling and other auxiliary operations. Now, surprisingly, this number has been coming down quite drastically over the recent years. Right, I think 10 years ago, 1.5 was a good number, which means that you're spending 50% of your power on cooling. Now, you know, numbers which are less than 1.1 are typical of the newly constructed data centers, especially the ones, so the new one of by Facebook in Oregon has 1.08, which is only 8% of the power is actually spent in cooling and other overhead. And the main part of this is the cooling operations, right? So typically, or at least traditionally, you've had air conditioning systems to keep these servers cool. Now, as you can imagine, you would need a lot of cooling capacity because you're packing in, you know, hundreds of thousands of servers in sort of small rooms, and that generates a lot of heat, and you need efficient thermal management to take all that heat away. So the easiest way to do it is to have a big HVAC system, but that can also mean a lot of power consumption. So these days, it's mostly relying on free air cooling, which means that you sort of take cold air from outside and pump it in and take some of the heat generated by the servers away. Now, this leads to interesting trade-offs, which I will discuss later. But the main thing is power consumption is a very important factor, and cooling is a big component of it, which somehow you need to reduce. So this diagram shows, you know, the inside of one of Google's data centers, and it looks, if you can see it, less like a data center and more like some kind of a boiler room with, you know, pipes of all colors and shapes going in and out, carrying sort of hot and cold air and water and whatnot in and around the whole data center itself. So the other main challenge is how do you power all these servers? Again, you can either rely on the electricity grid itself, right? And so if you're doing that, then these data centers, especially the large ones, are located in areas where you can get very cheap electricity. Right? For example, the Holyoke data center in GHPCC, which is in which UMass is a partner, that is located next to the Holyoke canal system, and they get a very cheap electricity from the hydroelectric power produced in that canal. That's one small example, and the bigger data center you have, the cheaper electricity you're going to need. So that is the key determinant of what location you want to set up your data center in. Now, in addition to the grid, you can also use renewable power like solar and wind. There are a lot of challenges associated with using these things. These are intermittent, they're not very reliable, so you need some kind of batteries or energy storage infrastructure, which again costs a lot of money. So there's a whole trade-off between, you know, how you're going to power your servers and their trade-off costs. So actually a lot of engineering goes into designing data centers, and at all levels, from thermal engineering to these days, a lot of electrical engineering is involved. For example, just as a small example, right? Typically, what would happen is that you pump in AC mains to your data center and to all the racks themselves. And what would happen if you would run, if you want to run a server from the mains, you got to. So most servers at their internal motherboard uses a 12 volt DC array, right? And every server has an AC to DC conversion unit in form of their power supply, right? And that is small. That has to have that creates a lot of heat. You know, that's not very efficient either. That's about 80% efficient in terms of this thing. So an alternative way is you want to convert AC to 12 volt DC somewhere centrally in your data center, right? And then have a 12 volt power supply to all your servers. This way you eliminate the additional conversion from AC to DC in each of the servers, and you do it centrally, you do it more efficiently. You can cool your AC to DC converter properly rather than worrying about cooling each of your servers in. So you have all these kind of, let's say, non-computer science engineering feats, which are responsible for driving this PUE down, right? So a lot of it is actual engineering, which goes into creating efficient data centers. So in addition to power, there's also a huge amount of investment in what kind of servers are you going to run. Now, I don't know if you've seen, but off-the-shelf servers, like, come in certain form factors, like 1 unit or 2 units of rack. They have standard dimensions, which you can easily plug and play onto different racks. Now, servers are efficient, there's no doubt about it, but at scale, especially at Google or Facebook scale, what they want to do is have custom servers which fit, you know, their data center design and their operating requirements. And so now they have started this open compute project. I think that's Facebook mostly. Yeah. Which, you know, so basically is their own server design of how the motherboard should look like, where should the components go. It also deals with very small details of, you know, how do you want airflow within your server rack and all those minor details. And so they have sort of also open sourced their design so that other companies which want to start these huge data centers can use some of their designs. But how useful they are to other people, we don't know yet. So, as I alluded to earlier, this sort of thermal management is a very key property, right, which data center operators have to provide. And there are some interesting issues, especially with free cooling, right? So the thing is that there's this trade-off. So every 1 degree Celsius increase in your data center temperature reduces your cost by around 5%. So that's huge. 5% operating costs is huge. But then that increase in temperature also causes your hardware to fail at a higher rate. So there have been these two studies, very interesting studies on how is server hardware affected by increasing temperature. Right? This is a 2012 paper on, you know, in general, what's the failure characteristics like with increasing temperature, and is that worth the cost? So you're saving some operating costs by not having a very expensive cooling system, but then more of your components are failing, which you have to replace, and your entire software stack and architecture might have to change because you are assuming that have a lot more failures than you had originally planned for. There's a new paper in FAST, which is the File Systems and Storage Conference this year, which tackled a very interesting study of, you know, how do environmental conditions with free air cooling, how do they affect hard disk reliability? That's a very long-term study of some Microsoft data centers, and that's a fascinating paper. Which one of the best papers this year, by the way? So look it up if you're interested in these kind of things. So lastly, from a practitioner's point of view, if you're interested in data center operations and how they're built and designed, so James Hamilton is Amazon's chief data center architect and responsible for all their infrastructure. And he maintains a very informative blog, like here, on, you know, data center design and trade-offs and a lot of sort of practitioner wisdom and guidance. Oh, and yeah, here's the sort of every HPC data center. Sorry about the projector quality here, but that's pretty big. And we also have a new addition to the data center, which was handled by Prashant, which is a solar hut. So it's a small data center, which is exclusively powered by solar panels. There are issues about that, like how do you maintain power, how do you schedule tasks and cooling and all of those issues. So data center designs have sort of evolved. I think 4 or 5 years ago, there was a trend on, you know, very cute data center designs. I think Sun and Google came up with this design of sort of modular data centers inside, you know, standard shipping containers. And the idea was that you could set up all the cabling and the infrastructure and servers in these shipping containers, and, you know, move them around, and it's going to become modular and easy to maintain, and you can just have a data center is basically just a collection of these shipping containers. You plug them into the grid and the network, and you're all set. But I think we are sort of moving past this model of having larger and more dedicated data centers. I don't know whether these are around these days. There's also this crazy proposal, which I think got implemented, with having this kind of a watertight shipping container and, you know, plunk it into the ocean and save on cooling costs. You get sort of free ocean-based cooling. So people have tried all sorts of things to see, you know, what techniques work, and a lot of sort of non-computer science techniques being used to drive these things. So as I covered, you know, you need energy efficiency. That's a big, big driving challenge. And the other thing which I'm going to get to is, how do you handle your resources efficiently, right? So now that you have set up your data center, right, now that it has servers, how do you actually run software on it efficiently? And so we'll get to this later. But the main challenges here are, obviously, you want high performance, you want to be able to schedule multiple users and multiple application groups on your data center. So Google, for example, right, has their main challenges. They have production workloads, which are the workloads created by user activity. So if you're using Gmail, your workload is production. That's important. But then they also have a huge amount of non-production workloads. All their batch, MapReduce, analytics jobs, and people want to run experiments on some data and all that. So they have a huge amount of non-production workload, which is not deadline sensitive. So then how do you balance the sort of production workloads and non-production workloads on top of your data center, right? And so a huge amount of work in that area on how do you pack, how do you schedule, how do you, you know, account for those things, how do you charge production versus non-production, and those kind of issues. There are other reliability challenges. The big list by Jeff Dean on how do you handle faults in a physical infrastructure. Every once in a while, there are these global cloud outages. I think last week was Google's turn, right? They had some 15-minute global outage on their complete public cloud, right? As a result of, I think, a router misconfiguration, as it always is. But so I think hardware faults are a lot rarer than sort of software glitches, and this sort of shows why the hardware is quite reliable. Lastly, this is about costs, and this is a slightly older diagram from 2008. So this is your server hardware cost, right? So that's around 60% of your operating costs, like amortized. And then this is, so around 1/3 to 1/4 is your power and cooling infrastructure, and that's, you know, all that. Then obviously you want to power your cooling and your servers. That's the green power slice. And sort of as you're seeing, the trend is that this is getting, the cooling and power infrastructure is getting more and more efficient and more power, this thing. And servers are getting more expensive to sort of buy and maintain because there are so many of them. And so these data centers exploit economies of scale, right? The more servers you have, the less manpower you need to maintain them, and all kinds of automation techniques to, you know, reduce your operating costs even further. And so hence, we are seeing sort of rise of massive data centers. So now that we have massive data centers, right, the other challenge is, what kind of software should you run on them? And how do you manage all these servers? So we're going to be looking, so this is the software stack which Google has disclosed, at least publicly, right? So at the lower level, you have systems like Borg and Omega, which essentially are cluster management and cluster scheduling softwares, right? So they operate either within a data center or across data centers, and they handle challenges like, if an application needs, 10,000 machines, and needs it now, right? You want to run some massively parallel operation on 10,000 machines. Systems like Borg and Omega are going to give you the right 10,000 machines to operate on. And this is a non-trivial problem, right? So those 10,000 machines, some of them may die, so you need something more. There's some kind of race condition issues, which I'll get to later, and those things. So once you have these machines, you can build a layer of software based on top of that, like storage systems and all kinds of storage systems and key value stores and elastic block stores, etc. So let's look at cluster scheduling, right? The task of you have an application you want to run and you want to find servers to run it. So Google has released sort of three main things. The Borg is essentially bin packing. Then you have Omega, which is their cluster scheduler. And then you have Kubernetes, which is their cluster scheduler plus this whole notion of containers and things like Docker, etc. In the open source world, you have projects like Apache Mesos, and Hadoop has their cluster scheduler called Yarn, which is yet another resource navigator. Both of them are quite popular and can sort of scale to large number of clusters and all that. And all cluster schedulers here have sort of slightly different designs, which if you're interested in, you should definitely look into. But so the main common theme of these sort of five schedulers is that they are mostly centralized, where if you want 10,000 machines, you go to a server, which is the cluster manager, or which runs a cluster management service, and then you ask for 10,000 machines. And then it will give you a list of 10,000 machines to run on. Right? So that's a centralized architecture. Recently, papers like Sparrow have proposed and championed distributed scheduling, or decentralized scheduling, where they use the power of two choices and don't rely on a central scheduling entity. The motivation is that the central scheduling entity is going to become bottleneck. And when you want very low latency tasks, you don't want to wait for the central scheduler to run a scheduling algorithm and get back to you. So in distributed scheduling, in Sparrow in particular, you use power of two choices, which means that you take, if you want to spawn one task on one server, you ask for two servers. So you pick two servers at random and you run the same task on those two servers. And this can mitigate stragglers, right? So if one server is overloaded, that will be slow, so you kill that task. If the other server has resources available, it can run. Right? The idea is that you want to do this kind of power of two choices, not have a centralized scheduler and so on. So recently, there's a lot of interest. Oops. Yeah, so I mean, scheduling is surprisingly active now. Recently, there was a paper which won the best written paper at Eurosys on TetrisCAD, which is kind of Tetris, and they use ideas from that to have combinatorially optimized scheduling placements. You know, different tasks may need different kind of resources like GPUs, etc. And then how do you do that in an efficient manner? So all this, you know, having a good scheduler and having a good software stack sort of enables you to run what's called the cloud on your data center, right? And so it provides remote availability, pay-as-you-go, very highly scalable, and most importantly, shared infrastructure. So you can run your applications alongside other applications. And so the key enabler of cloud, in my opinion, is hardware virtualization. Right? That's the key building block, which I'm sure has been covered. So you have one server partitioned on multiple virtual machines, and all good things happen. And the cute thing you can do with VMs are like, you know, live migration and move things from one hardware machine to another if one becomes overcrowded or one fails and all that. And as far as I know, Google is the only cloud provider to publicly disclose that they use live migration. Amazon has been very coy about it, and people don't know whether they use migration or not. But Google certainly does. And so you can, there are basically two choices of hypervisors right now on the public cloud. You either have Xen or KVM. KVM is used by Google, and I'm not sure who else, but Xen is used by Amazon predominantly. And obviously the Microsoft Azure cloud uses their own Hyper-V thing, which is not here, by the way. On the desktop, you have things like VMware and VirtualBox, which you already used. So which is good. Well, let's move on to the interesting things, right? So far, in order to enable multiple applications to run on a single physical machine, people have used virtual machines, which have proven to be very reliable, very secure, reasonably high performance for most applications, and things have been good. But then, so virtual machines clearly have these two big advantages, right? That is, you can run completely different operating systems, and your choice of operating system and libraries and applications and all that. So you get a machine which behaves just like a physical machine. Because of this, it also provides isolation in terms of performance and security. So you don't let other applications on the same physical machine interfere with what you do. You can be quite confident that the hypervisor is going to be securely implemented, and you will not have attacks between VMs on the same machine. So both of these are great advantages. But now we're seeing the rise of containers. And the question is, why? So let's look at the first advantage, that the ability to run different operating systems. And well, thing is that people only use one operating system on the cloud, and that's Linux. This advantage that you can run different operating systems is really not exploited on a large scale. People want standardization, standard software stacks, Linux is convenient to set up, etc. And so, if everybody is using Linux as their guest operating system, then maybe you can use operating system virtualization. That is, you share the operating system instead of sharing at the hardware level. And then you run multiple containers. And that's kind of a new trend, especially with Docker. I mean, everybody's using Docker for whatever reason, right? And now the thing is, people are questioning, do we need heavyweight virtual machines? Right? Sure, they provide isolation, but can we use containers instead? Right? And containers, correctly implemented, right, they sort of promise this perfect compartmentalization, right, with bare metal performance. So you don't need, you don't pay the virtualization tax. So on other operating systems, like Solaris and BSD, container implementation is quite mature. Right? And there's a company called Giant, which runs a fairly large public cloud, which provides containers by default. So they don't run containers inside virtual machines, like what other companies do. And the reason they can do that is they run Solaris or a derivative of Solaris called Illumos as their main host operating system, which has a pretty mature container implementation. So as a result, you can run your applications inside containers, not on virtual machines, and avoid paying the virtualization overhead. But on other clouds, if you want to run containers, you run them inside virtual machines. And you use the sort of package management properties of containers and those things, you take advantage of that. So clouds are of three main types. At the bottom, you have infrastructure as a service, which provides raw infrastructure, mostly in the form of VMs. Although there are some bare metal clouds which provide you access to actual bare metal servers. Then you go higher up the stack, you have platform as a service which provide you a software platform with a set of APIs which you can deploy your software on. So instead of running your own operating system and your own libraries, the platform as a service clouds provide you with those things. And you use their APIs in order to deploy your applications. And lastly, there's software as a service, which is basically, you know, the software itself is going to be hosted by the cloud. I'm not going to touch upon this in today's talk. So let's look at infrastructure as a service and Amazon. And you have already used EC2, hopefully. Is that assignment over, by the way?
Yeah.
Okay. And have you guys shut down your virtual machines? Okay. All right. Just a reminder for those who haven't. So which machines did you use? I think M3 small?
M1.
M1 small, yeah. M1 small. Right. So that's a small one, costs 2 cents an hour or less, and so you can pick from a very large variety of machines which provide, which are in different space of CPU, memory, and you know GPUs and IO capabilities and all that. They have a very rich catalog of these servers, and it's really amazing, right? You say EC2 run instance, and you get your very own virtual machine in like what, less than a minute? How much time does it take to run an EC2 VM? Minute or so, right? So it's really fast. So this is your own virtual machine, which has been booted with the image of your choice in under a minute, right? So that's fantastic. And once you have that virtual machine, you can run whatever you want on it, right? It's yours, full. There's another approach, right, of platform as a service. And I think one good example of that used to be Google App Engine, which was popular, but now, has it been shut down? I think so, I'm not sure. But the idea is that you want to provide very convenient APIs for your end users to use, right? So you already have databases set up, some kind of databases, very rich APIs. And the idea was that you would take less effort to deploy, to create new applications in the cloud. So instead of taking your existing application and porting it on the cloud, by using these APIs, it is cheaper and also more efficient in terms of performance, because platform as a service providers have sort of optimized their operations for these use cases. Now there are many programming models, right? Obviously things like MapReduce are very popular on the cloud. People are batch processing, so you fire a job, forget about it, and you don't really care about when it completes. Or more interactive things like client-server architectures, right, which need the machine to be always on. Then there's this dichotomy between public and private clouds. I have mostly talked about public clouds right now, which means anybody is free to use their resources as long as they pay. And the other is private cloud, where you would set it up in your own organization. Then that's for your internal needs. This thing of a hybrid cloud seems to promise the best of both worlds, where you have a private cloud, you link it with a public cloud for issues like scaling. So you may want to run your workload internally to as much degree as possible. And when you have a spike in demand, you may want to use the resources of public cloud. So hybrid clouds obviously are very attractive to big businesses, because you want to run things internally and use the sort of unlimited capacity of public clouds for scaling and those issues. So we have mostly talked about virtual machines and containers and sort of computing as a service right now, right? So focus on computing. But the cloud ecosystem has sort of grown tremendously. So if you look at computing itself, on Amazon, as you have used EC2, which is their compute service. So you create VMs on demand. But Amazon itself has a huge number of other computing services which they provide. So they have this thing called Elastic MapReduce, where you can run your Hadoop applications on top of their managed infrastructure. So you don't have to really go set up VMs, create a Hadoop cluster on the VMs, run the job, configure HDFS, all that. So all that is sort of taken care of you, and that sort of blurs the line between infrastructure as a service and platform as a service, because now they're providing you this sort of Hadoop platform to run on, right? And you sort of see this theme over and over again for different cloud providers as well. The line between the most large cloud providers are now providing infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and a wide range of products in that whole spectrum. Amazon is also now providing containers as a service. So you can run containers like Docker or whatever, just say Docker run. They do the job of, you know, finding a VM and running the container inside the VM and all of that. Recently, their most interesting and controversial service has been Lambda, which arises from the intuition that most computing is essentially responding to events. So if you think of client server, you know, you're responding to a request from a client. So Lambda is a service in which you don't maintain a long-running server. Instead, you specify event handlers. And you say, if this event occurs, I want to run this piece of code, which may issue some database transaction, write to a file system, and respond. Right? So now, this promises true sort of serverless computing, where instead of having the whole hassle of finding a server and doing capacity planning, how many servers do I need, how large should they be, you know, what software should run on them, you simply specify event handlers, and that's it. You're done. Right? So you upload your event handling code, and Amazon will take care of, you know, fault tolerance and replication and scalability for you. But this comes at a cost, right? So now it's charged on a per event basis. So the pricing models themselves are very interesting. So in case of EC2, you're charged per hour, I hope you know. So it's charged per hour, you can do whatever you want on it, right? It can be idle, you can mine Bitcoin, it's yours. With things like Lambda, it's more, you know, you're really paying for what you're using. So if you're having a very idle application, it might be good. But if you get a large burst of traffic and you want to respond to a large amount of events, you may end up with a very large bill. So this is a nice trade-off between sort of paying for a VM to the black box, you know, what you want, versus paying for sort of micro services. So I've used that term in a different context here. Sorry about that. Similarly, if you look at storage, right, there's this thing called EBS, the Elastic Block Storage, right, which essentially is a virtual hard disk for you. Right? So that virtual hard disk is yours. You can format it, use it on a file system, do what you want with it. Then we have S3, Amazon's very famous web-based key value store, right, which provides a more coarse-grained abstraction. Right? It's an object storage system. Then it also has something called Glacier, which is a long-term storage system, where if you want to archive a very large amount of data and store it at very, very low costs, then Glacier is a system for you. So again, that's a very rich ecosystem of, you know, different kind of storage speed, storage costs, and storage abstractions. Similarly, if you look at databases, you know, instead of deploying your own database, you can use Amazon's DynamoDB or their relational database service, or systems like Redshift, which are again, you know, long-term data storage. So it's a rich ecosystem. It's not just a VM, it's not just EC2. And using all these tools and services can make your application faster, more cost effective, more scalable, and it's more in sync with the cloud philosophy of using, you know, built-in services. So you're sort of sharing. So what it means with a shared infrastructure is that you're using the infrastructure, both software and hardware, provided by the cloud. For the instance of, for example, you know, relational DB service, you are using, you know, the relational databases which are already set up for you by the cloud provider. And this enables, you know, ease of scaling and some of those issues. Lastly, I mean, this is definitely not infrastructure as a service. Amazon also provides very high level services, like, you know, email services. So if you want to send emails, you don't have to set up postfix on inside your own VM. Right? They have this Route 53, which is their email server. You just set up this. Similarly, for message queuing, you know, you don't have to set up 0MQ or whatever. You can use their own message queuing service. They have this, their machine learning library, which is not as popular, but it's pretty cool. And they also have a micropayment service. If you want to, like, do some Bitcoin transactions and let Amazon handle the final details for you, use their micropayment service. So it's a pretty rich ecosystem. It's not just EC2. It's not just the M1 smalls and EBS volumes. It's a lot more you can do with it. And in the end, it's to make things very easy to set up and convenient to use. So we talked about scalability, and obviously privacy and security are big challenges, more with containers, but even with VMs. You have issues like, so let's say you're running your VM on Amazon, and for whatever reason, Amazon wants to see what's running inside that VM. A, is it possible? Show of hands. Is it possible? Yeah. You know, if you have control of the hardware and you control the hypervisor, right, then that's it. That's game over. Even if you sort of encrypt things and all that, where is the encryption key being stored? It's stored in memory of that server, which Amazon has access to. But so how do you sort of, you know, solve that problem? This is especially a bigger problem currently with government surveillance and all that. Right? Luckily, there is a technology called Intel SGX, which stands for Software Guard Extensions, which claims, or their intention is that you will be protected from these kind of attacks. So even if you do not trust your operating system, even if you do not trust your hypervisor, even if you do not trust your cloud operator, you will still be able to protect your secrets. And that relies on encryption built inside the CPU. So that's one possible avenue for improving security and privacy in the cloud. Now let's turn to some of my work on sort of cloud economics. So, we saw you have all these services, especially for VMs, you pay per hour, right? Now, what are the challenges the cloud faces? Well, you need to be able to provide virtual machines on demand within a minute or so, right, to whoever asks for it, which means you have to spawn up a VM on a physical server. Now, to do that, you need to maintain a large server farm, a big data center, it's all right. But then you also will have idle servers. You have these sort of huge racks of servers not being used at the moment. But you still need to maintain them, because in the future, if you have a request, let's say whatever 677 class is running their assignment last minute and launching a lot of VMs, you know, those VMs have to be started on some servers. So you need to keep a lot of idle servers. The question is, what do you do with that spare or excess capacity? So one option is to shut them down. You have an idle server, you shut it down. That's one option. But as we just saw, 60% of the operating costs are actually the server infrastructure investment. Right? So you've already spent a huge amount of money, you know, buying those servers and maintaining them and all that. And so shutting them down may not be the best thing to do. What instead you can do, you can sell your spare capacity at extremely low cost just to break even and have a small profit. And we are seeing these sort of large cloud providers like Amazon and Google have what are called as transient servers. They're very low cost, right? They're 70 to 90% cheaper. But they have this key property that they can be terminated at any time. Now, the on-demand servers which you used for your assignment, right, they get terminated only when you terminate them, right? So you need to say EC2 terminated instance or shut down or power off or whatever, and you can use them for as long as you want. These transient servers don't have that property. You use them and suddenly Amazon can decide to kill it. So you have this trade-off. They're not reliable, they're volatile and fickle, but they're very low cost, 90% cheaper. And that's a big appeal. So Amazon has this thing called spot instances, where their price changes with time. And that's a result of a second price auction. So if you want to use a spot instance, you place a bid that is, which is an intent, which means I'm willing to pay this much money per hour to keep using that server. And they run an auction periodically and determine a market price. If this price is above your bid price, then you will get thrown out and you have no recourse. Right. So the blue line here shows the spot price of some instance over time. Right. And the red line is what you actually bid. And you can't change your bid, right? Once you have bid for a server, it stays that way. So I bid something which means I'm willing to pay this much, but it's a second price auction. So you actually only end up paying the actual spot price, which is much lower than your bid. So things are smooth until here, but due to market conditions, either an increase in demand or a decrease in supply, the spot price increases and it crosses your bid, at which point you face a revocation and your server is terminated. So it's gone, right? The price may come down again and you may want to bid again and keep using a different server of the same type, and so on. So that's the challenge, right, with spot instances, that you get 90% savings, but then your instances are not very reliable. And so the question is, like, you know, can you use these spot instances to run different kinds of applications with higher availability and, you know, sort of good performance? Because if you get terminated here, you know, you lose state, you may need to rerun your application, etc. So spot instances are like that. You bid, you get terminated when your bid is lower than the spot price. Right, and what can you do with it, right? So one option is that you can use checkpointing to keep saving your instance and application state to some permanent storage. You keep using checkpointing, and then when you get a revocation, right, when you are actually terminated, you can resume from a previous checkpoint. So there are two main approaches to this kind of a checkpointing system. If you want to run general purpose applications, you will need nested virtualization and you checkpoint periodically your nested VM. So nested virtualization is you're running a hypervisor on top of bare metal software or on top of bare metal hardware. On top of this hypervisor, you're running a virtual machine. Inside this virtual machine, you're running another hypervisor, and then you're running a virtual machine, you know, on top of this nested hypervisor. Right? So why is that required, right? Well, that's required because in public clouds, if you want to checkpoint or migrate your VM, you can't do it, right? You get access to virtual machine. You do not get to control the hypervisor which it runs on. Because the hypervisor is shared, the hypervisor is controlled by the cloud operator and not you, so on. So even though virtual machines enable easy migration and checkpointing and record replay and all these things, as a user, you cannot use these services. So instead, what we decided was that, well, let's add another layer of indirection, which is the favorite trick and tool of all computer science people. Just add another layer of indirection. You're running a hypervisor, let's run another hypervisor, right? Who cares? Well, there is some performance. There is a lot of performance penalty with nested virtualization. Now, this again is an active area of research on how to reduce the performance penalty of nested hypervisors. We use something called Zen Blanket, which enabled. So Amazon runs the Zen hypervisor. We use Zen Blanket, which enables us to run Zen virtual machines on top of Zen virtual machines, and so on. So that was called a system called Spot Check. Recently, we have a system called Flint, which does this for Spark applications. So Spark is this newer avatar of MapReduce and Hadoop, and it supports richer semantics and much better performance and all that. Supports sort of batch and interactive data processing, and you run this sort of big data applications on these very cheap spot servers, right? Because this is an ideal fit. You want to run your data processing on hundreds or thousands of servers, and obviously that cost starts adding up. But if you use spot servers, you save 90%. So you want big data at 90% of our cost, but then if you get terminated, you lose state, you have to start again. So you do periodic checkpointing and for Spark applications, such that if there's a failure, you detect it and you resume from previous checkpoint. Lastly, so we sort of found that. So okay, let's see, how many server types are there on Amazon? Ballpark. So we used one, which is Amazon Small. Did you observe any other server types? The large, maybe large, medium, all that, and they have different types. So basically, so turns out they have some 30 to 40 different server types, and they operate all these types on different geographical regions. They have some 5 or 6 regions. Each region has different data centers, which they call availability zones. So each of these defines a market. Now this spot bidding thing, which I showed, operates on a per market, on a per server type basis. So every server type will have its own market. And we sort of found that if you look at, for some reason, these different server markets are largely uncorrelated in their failures. So what that means is that if the price increases for an M1 small instance, right, it's not necessary that the price will increase even for the M1 large instance at the same time. So because you have this uncorrelated failures among different markets, what you can do is you can deploy your applications on different markets so that even if one market fails because the spot price increases, you can still keep running on the other spot markets. Yeah, so to wrap up, talked about the three layers: the physical data center layer, software stack for scheduling and virtualization, and some of the infrastructure cloud aspects of, you know, what are the services being offered by major clouds today and what are their advantages, and some research topics. Right. That's it. Thanks. You guys didn't ask any questions. So any questions? No? All right. Yeah.
For your nested virtualization, that's the virtual machine running inside the AC thread, but you don't have to show it or anything. That has, I mean, that's the state that you want to back up, right?
Exactly, yeah.
So why couldn't you back up the application of the applications, very tight. Why couldn't you back up the state of the applications running outside the outer virtual machine in the same way that you back up the state of the overall?
Right, so the thing is, we don't have access to control that virtual machine, right? Because that's controlled by the hypervisor underneath. So quickly, so this is your hardware. On top of this, Amazon runs their hypervisor, right? This is the Amazon on which they give you a VM. So this is the VM instance which they give you. Now we can't migrate or checkpoint this VM, because doing so would mean the cooperation of the hypervisor. Because these operations are at the hypervisor level. So we can't really touch this. We can't ask it to help us. So the only way to get around this, or one of the ways to get around this, is to add another layer of interaction. Inside this virtual machine, this is ours. We can do what we want inside this. So we run another hypervisor called Zen Blanket. And then on top of this, we sort of run the actual virtual machine that the user wants to run. So this is the sort of user VM. And now you want to transfer this state inside this user virtual machine, which we can do because we run Zen Blanket. So if you want to migrate this to another physical machine, right, you do it by starting another VM, starting Zen Blanket, and just copying the state of this user VM to a different VM. If there are no more questions, we can call it a day.